I am glad to be back with you after, I was trying to figure out when it was, last fall, I think. And Rod and Gail needed some time to get away. And so he asked me if I would share with you from the scriptures 2 weeks. I'm not sure if he asked me for 2 weeks because he wasn't sure he'd get guests to get back for next week or what exactly what the reason for that was. But if I'm here the third week, you know that they're stuck in Carolina Beach without gas, so hopefully that doesn't happen. And to your point, Gene, I can go back, and I know a number of you can, well, maybe not a lot of you, but can go back further than that 70s time about gas. This was not a period of gas shortage, but when I was in college, the one down the road in Raleigh, okay, that one. When I was in college, I had gone to high school in Goldsboro, and so plenty of weekends I would drive from Raleigh to Goldsboro and visit with my girlfriend and her family, and would get gas somewhere in Clayton or Smithfield, somewhere on Highway 70 between Raleigh and Goldsboro, and gas was about 18 cents a gallon. These were the time of the, have any of you ever heard of the gas wars? There were gas wars that were driving the price down. Well, but that's another story. But that was at least relevant to our current situation. I told Rod before he left town, I said, Rod, I am concerned about one thing. I don't have a clip from an Andy Griffith episode. And Rod said, Floyd, You understand that that's not the part that's inspired by God, right? That's kind of an extra add-on to see where you makes you wonder, where's he going to go with this? And I'm always fascinated to see when I see the Andy Griffith, because I grew up watching the Andy Griffith Show, as some of you did, and I'm going, where's he going to go with this? This is going to be fun. But so I did tell him that, yes, I was clear that this was the part that was actually inspired. So let me pray and ask the Lord to speak his truth. What I really want this morning is for God to speak his words to your life and your situation through what I say. And what I find is that often what people hear is what they need to hear. And that's my prayer. Father, we give our time to you this morning. Thank you for the time of worship. Your name is beautiful. And we love you for that. I pray this morning that the words that I share will be consistent with what you've revealed. We give our time to you now and pray you'll be honored in that. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to look at a book of the Bible that I think is paid way too little attention to today. It's a 4 chapters long book in the Old Testament. And to tell you what that book is, actually, I think Rob might have already told you, I'm not sure. We'll see. But as of Friday, I got this that I'm dropping all over the place. I met with a friend of mine. He's been a friend for 30 years. And during his retirement years, he's made it a hobby of doing genealogical research. And so he offered, there are some things about my family that I know very little about, really on both my mom's and my father's side. And so he's real deep into Ancestry, Ancestry.com, and did some research. And this is what he brought to me. And there's like lots of names in here. I never met, one of the reasons I was interested, and I still don't know much more about this, but I never met my grandparents on my father's side. Never met them. I asked my brother recently, I said, am I just mistaken? Do I not remember it? But we actually did meet them. I know their names, but I don't know anything about them. And so I'm not sure why. I don't know if there was something in my dad's family that he was shamed by or embarrassed by. I just don't know. But I would like to know. But I probably won't know. Now, I'm starting there to say, that when I first saw this list, this is a list of names. And he did get me a little information about some of the people on my mother's side and on my father's side. Now, I'm starting there because there are lots of genealogies in the Bible. And one of the genealogies, one of a number of them, is found in Matthew chapter 1. And of course, it's the genealogy of Jesus. And in the genealogy of Jesus, so this is headed for a book about a person who shows up in the genealogy of Jesus. So Matthew starts, this is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. So to Jews, Matthew's writing to Jews, and he's showing them that Jesus was not only a Jew, but as he needed to be, as the Messiah was prophesied to be, a descendant of Abraham and of King David. So he says, this is the genealogy of Jesus, son of David, son of Abraham. And then he says, Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob, and he starts going down. Father of. Until he gets to Boaz. And then he says about Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz, the father of Obed. Now I'm going to call him the Hebrew pronunciation of Obed is Oved, O-B-E-D, Oved, whose mother was Ruth. Now there are only five women listed in this genealogy of Jesus, and Ruth is one of the five. Well, we know some things. So I've got a bunch of names here about my ancestors, but this one, God chooses out of 66 books in the Bible to put an entire book of the Bible about this person, about Ruth. And I've wondered, why is so little made? I don't know how much you know about the person of Ruth. Maybe you know something about her story, but not very much is made of her story. And I think that's to our detriment. Because it turns out that the circumstances of her life are amazing. I have located some professors of ancient Near Eastern literature who weren't Christians to my knowledge, but who said that the story of Ruth is one of the greatest short stories in all of the ancient Near East. And yet, why don't we know much about Ruth? So we're going to look at it. And I think the reason might be is that in the Old Testament times, it was men who were given most attention to. The patriarchs, the kings, the prophets. Now, there were some female prophetesses, but the prophets were mostly males. So it's mostly about men. But the book of Ruth is about two very ordinary women. And it's an amazing story. So here we go. Let's first of all see if I can operate this. So we're looking at the story of Ruth. It's a book about two very ordinary women who experience the amazing operation in their life experience of the grace of God. I'm getting at this point in my life where I find myself asking more and more, what kind of memories am I leaving for my children and my grandchildren? And this is a book about, and there are plenty of times when I feel like, well, a couple generations from now, they're not going to know what my name was. I feel very ordinary. Well, These are very ordinary ladies. And the reason I think this book is so exciting is because these two ordinary ladies experienced in their life the amazing love of God. A.W. Tozer, made this statement. He said, "What comes into our mind when we think about God is the most important thing about us." To stop and just kind of reflect on that for a moment. When you think about God, what comes into your mind? And he says, it's the most important thing about you. Because it affects how we see life. It affects how we respond to the circumstances of our life. It's the most important thing about us. Now, with that said, here's how the book starts. So we're going here. She is in the genealogy of Jesus. She is one of Jesus' lineal ancestors. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. So there are two things I want us to notice here, because they're time indicators and they are clues to this book. First of all, it says, in the days when the judges ruled. The period of judges, let me give you some historical context. I'm going to give you some dates. You probably won't remember them, but it's okay. We're going to give you several really simple, fairly easy to remember dates, actually. The time of Abraham was about 2000 BC. So that's the time of Abraham. Come down 500 years later. The time of Moses, 1500. So, okay. The time of Abraham was when BC? 2000. Time of Moses, 1500. And then we come down to the time of David. So these are key people in the Old Testament, about 1,000. So 2,000, 1,500, 1,000. So the time of 2,000 is the time of? Okay, see if you're still with me here. Time 1,500 BC is the time of Moses. And then 1,000 BC, the time of David. Now, in between Moses and David, there's the years of wandering in the wilderness. They come into the land. They take the land that God has promised them. And for the next 400 years, so this period of time between Moses, 1500, and David, 1000, during that period of time is the time of the judges. Now, I don't know what you remember about the period of the judges, but the period of the judges is the ugliest, worst part of Israel's history. It is a horrible time of history. When the people had come through the wilderness for 40 years under Moses' leadership, and in the book of Deuteronomy, Moses prepares the people to enter the land. He tells them, he gives them instructions about how to follow Yahweh, the name by which God reveals himself, how to follow Yahweh in the land, and warns them, they are to drive the Canaanites out of the land. This is the land God had promised Abraham. He tells them to drive the Canaanites. And the reason for that is because he warns them that if you don't, you'll follow the gods of the Canaanites, which was basically you will worship Baal. And I'm not going to get into all that, but look up sometime the Baal worship, and it was a horrible, horrible religion, if you will. And he said, I don't want you falling into idolatry. So he warns them about falling, and he tells them what'll happen if they do. And what he says will happen if they don't fall into idolatry, if they follow him, they'll experience peace. But then if they turn to idols, they'll experience, the first thing he mentions is, and this is all in the book of Deuteronomy, They'll experience famine. If the famine doesn't drive them back to God, they'll experience being buffeted, if you will, by foreign nations. And if that doesn't do it, there will be outright warfare. So they'll be attacked by foreign nations. So when we read that the book of Ruth happens in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. So the fact that there was a famine in the land tells us what has happened. What have they fallen into? They've fallen into idolatry. So the two key words in the first verse are judges and famine. That tells us where we are historically. And what Moses reveals is that what they're to do, if they do fall into idolatry, is to repent. They're to repent and turn back to the true God. Okay. All right. This we're going to see in just a moment. Here is the land of Israel with the Sea of Galilee in the north, the Jordan River flowing out of the Sea of Galilee into the Dead Sea. On the west side is Jerusalem, and just below Jerusalem is Bethlehem, which is where we're going to see in just a moment which is where this family that the book is about was living, in Bethlehem. All right. And then if you'll notice on the other side is the land of Moab. The land of Moab is where the people are camped when Moses gives them the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy is basically divided up into three sections. You might think of it as like Moses preaching three sermons. And they're in the land of Moab, so they're getting ready to come across the Jordan River and take the land. All right. Let me give you one more clue to the book of Judges. We said it was like Israel's, one of their ugliest periods of history. At the end of the book of Judges, so this happened. Okay, remember, Old Testament, we got Joshua, Judges, Ruth. So Ruth follows the book of Judges. In fact, in some of the old actual manuscripts, Ruth is actually tacked onto the end of the book of Judges because it happens in the same period. In those days, in the days of the Judges, in those 400 years, so this is going on for a long time, there's constant cycles of falling into sin, being judged by God, repenting, and then God blessing them when they repent and turn to Him. But here's what the end of the book says. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Now, the clue there, we're not going to spend a lot of time there, but the problem here is that what they concluded when they would be attacked by a foreign country who was ruled by a king, remember, Israel didn't have kings at this time. They were led into the land under Joshua's leadership, and they didn't have a king. So they thought their problem was, we don't have a king. These other nations that are beating up on us have kings. Our problem is we need a king, which was not correct. What they needed to be doing was following Yahweh and being obedient. And then here's what they did as a result. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. That's the epitaph of the book of Judges. It was a period of time when everybody was doing what was right in his own eyes. I'm sure glad that I don't live in a time like that. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. That's the period of the Judges. It's saying, I'll do what I want to do. I determine what's right, which is another way of saying, I'm God. It's deifying self. Okay? Now, what we're going to discover here is that while this book, the book of Ruth, is a lovely story, and it's recognized all through literature, it's more than a lovely story. It's much more than that. Chapter 1, verse 1, told us when it happened, time of the judges. And it was a time of famine, so people are hungry. One of the things we're going to see here is that this book, and I want all of us to be thinking about this, the literary theme of the book of Ruth is about emptiness and fullness. There's all through the book, whenever you read the Bible, one of the things you want to notice is, what are the themes? What are the things that are repeated? What are the things that are compared and contrasted? And over in the book of Ruth, we're going to see times of fullness and emptiness. Have you had times of fullness in your life? Just things were just good. I would say for the most part, personally, this is the time of fullness for us, for my wife Diana and me. We're getting to spend lots of time with our kids locally and, more importantly, with their children, called our grandchildren. It's really, yesterday, our daughters married brothers, not their brothers, okay? Just to be clear here, I want to confuse this, but we didn't grow up in West Virginia. Excuse me. They married brothers, and one of them, Heather, got married 9 years before her sister Kelsey married Nate's brother. And we were, their parents were in the area as well, so we had met together, got together, spent time in his families together, and they barely ever spoke to each other. 9 years later, they got married. And so grandchildren, of our 9 grandchildren, 3 of them have birthdays in May. So Riley turned 17 yesterday. In May. Ainsley turned 15. And then Ryan, my youngest daughter's little boy, just turned 8. Now I'm sharing that with you because they had a birthday party and the cousins just love hanging out together and have a blast being together. And just sitting and watching it is so rich. I see a number of people nodding, not like nodding off, but nodding like, yeah, I know what you're talking about. I've been there, or we are there maybe right now. But it's a time of fullness. But we're going to discover something that happens. It says that it was a certain man. And it says now, the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. The names of his 2 sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. Now, one of the things that happens, and we're going to conclude this next week, so there is way more in the book of Ruth than I could cover in 2 weeks, but we'll do it. We'll cover the things that I feel like God has called us to focus on. But one of the things that's interesting in the book of Ruth is names. The names are fascinating. Every person in the book of Ruth is named, except for one. And so hold on to that, because I think probably I won't comment about why that happens until next week. But there's one person in the book who isn't even named. So the wife, the name of the man, so this family, this was his family living in Bethlehem, right? The future birthplace of the Messiah, right? It's prophesied that he would be born there. Well, this is where the family lives. They live in Bethlehem. The man's name is Elimelech. Now, the name Elimelech comes from really three words, if you will. El is the Hebrew word for God. When you add the I on it, it makes it my God. Eli is my God. And Melech is the Hebrew word for king. So his parents named him Elimelech, translated, my God is king. One of the ways that the Hebrews named their children, and there were a variety of ways they named them, but one of them was they would name them based on some character trait that they wanted them to have. So Elimelech's parents apparently named him because they were hoping that this newborn would grow up and follow God as his king. Okay? So that's Elimelech. And the name of his wife, Naomi. I've really grown to love this name because of its meaning. And again, we'll probably come back a little bit more to it next week. But the word Naomi, the Hebrew word Naomi, comes from the Hebrew word Nahom, N-A-H-O-M, N-A-H-O-M, Nahom. And when you add the E, it adds the pronoun my. So Nahom means pleasant. Pleasant. Her parents apparently named this infant daughter Pleasant because they wanted her to become a pleasant person. As I started studying this book, actually several months ago now, and had been interacting with Rod about it, that was one of the first things that affected me is, am I the kind of person who people would describe as pleasant? And the I adds my to it. So if you were translating Naomi, it would be translated like this, my pleasantness. So apparently, and I hope you'll really ponder this during the week, my pleasantness, what I think they were hoping was that this daughter would be so pleasant that she would draw people to the pleasantness of God. So one of the things that is going to keep coming up through this book is the nature of God. And they were hoping that their daughter would draw people to how pleasant God is. And in the name of their sons were Mahlon and Chilion. Those are, we'll come back to that next week. Right now I want to focus on the mother and the father, Elimelech and Naomi. So they're from Bethlehem. And remember, they're in a time of famine because of idolatry. People are worship, they are following foreign gods. They're following the gods of the Canaanites, Baal worship. And what they were to do when the time of idolatry and resulting famine came was they were to repent. Right? That's in the book of Judges, there are seven cycles like this. And God calls the people to repentance. And then when they repent, he frees them from the famine. And the rains come, and there's no longer famine in the land. But what did they do? They went into the country of Moab and remained there. They go to Moab. Moab is not only a foreign country, it's a pagan country, and they are enemies of Israel. So instead of repenting, what Elimelech does is he says, we're out of here. I think what we're going to see is that he leaves his countrymen. And it's ultimately symbolic of leaving their God. Because it says they went into the country of Moab and remained there. And then what happens? But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. All right, we have a family that's full. A husband, a wife, and two boys living in Bethlehem. So they're full in that sense. But it's a time of emptiness. And isn't this how life is? It kind of is filled with times of emptiness and times of fullness. They're full as a family, but there's emptiness because they're living in a time of famine. So they're getting out of Dodge. And then when they do, later on, Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, dies. And she was left with her two sons. Well, let's continue the story. Now, this is another example that shows that I think it's fair to conclude when we read this story that they've not only left their country and left their people, but they've left Yahweh. They've said, we're out of here. We're leaving it all. Because what happens? They took Moabite wives. So their boys married pagan women. The name of one of the wives was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth, about whom, one of the two heroes of this story. There's two heroes of this story, if you will. There's Naomi, my pleasantness, and there's Ruth. So let's see what happens. They lived there about 10 years, and both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman was left without her sons and her husband. So let's sort of let this sink in. They've been in a land of famine. They've been full as a family, but they're leaving. They hear that there is food in Moab, so they leave for Moab. And now, talk about emptiness. Naomi loses her husband. He dies, we don't know how old, but at an earlier age. And then both of her sons die. And so she's a widow. She's lost her husband. She lost both of her boys. So then what happens? We've got fullness, emptiness, fullness with the family together, then emptiness with husband and two boys who have died. So we've got emptiness there. And then here's what happens. Then she arose with her daughter-in-law to return from the country of Moab. So now later, she decides, it's time for me to go home. It's time for her to go back to Bethlehem. To return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the fields of Moab that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. Okay, so here's another clue about the time of Judges. There was a famine, but now there's food in Bethlehem. So what has happened in Bethlehem? There's been repentance. That's why there's food. So God has brought the rain, there's food, and she returns home. So she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-law, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. So Bethlehem is in Judah. Remember, the nation had divided into two, Israel in the north and Judah in the south. So Bethlehem is in the divided part of the nation of Israel called Judah. And so Naomi says to her two daughters-in-law, you go back to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. So here's, this kind of starts to bring what's going on in this story to the forefront. Because Naomi says to her daughters-in-law, I can't do anything for you now. See, there was a rule in the ancient Near East that if a woman was childless and lost her husband, in order for the family name to continue, a person who was related would marry the childless woman. And so the two daughters, Orpah and Ruth, have no children because their husbands have died young. And Ruth is going back to Bethlehem and she's saying, you just stay here because I can't help you. I don't have any other children. So had there been a third, the responsibility under the law of that third one would be to marry one of the childless women. But so she just says, go back to your mother's house because hopefully there'll be someone here in Moab for you. And what I want you to take you back to where we started this is that in the genealogy of Jesus, Ruth appears. But she's a pagan Moabite woman early on. But something has changed. Because Naomi says, may the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. And we're going to come back to this, but there's a word in here that I want to take a minute. And it's really what I hope, my desire is that if there's one thing you go away with today, this would be it. The word is kindly. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The word kindly, the Hebrew word kindly, is a Hebrew word. It's spelled H-E-S-E-D, and it's pronounced chesed. So you kind of, if you ever learned a language where you roll your R's, it's even more so than that. It's a hard H instead of a soft H. A soft H would be like the hallelujah, okay? Like hallelujah or Hanukkah. But chesed is a hard H. All right, just for fun, let's see if you can do that. So it's got to be chesed. Can you say chesed? All right, that's pretty good. Yeah, if somebody behind you feels air blowing on their neck, then you probably have done that properly. The word chesed is such a strong word about the nature of God that Hebrew, the translators of the Bible, have had a hard time translating it. They've translated it mercy. They've translated it kind. They've translated it loving. There's a lot of, but what's interesting is it's very difficult to find a word that is so strong, a Hebrew word that's so strong, or excuse me, an English word to translate chesed, that's strong enough. It's just a very strong word about the nature of God. So I had a professor at Dallas Seminary where, as you know, both Rod and I went. Since I was a little bit before his time, this was a professor that was not there by the time Rod got there. But Dr. Walke was the head of the Old Testament department. Head of the Old Testament department, one of the things that means is he could take a Hebrew Bible and what we call sight read it. Now, Rod and I had to take 2 years of Hebrew and 3 years of Greek, and we had to do some translation. So translation means you open up your Hebrew Bible and you start going word by word translating it. But Dr. Walke didn't need to do that. He could sight read it. That means you just open up the Hebrew text and read it. And Hebrew reads from right to left. So when you start reading Hebrew, you start reading Genesis. Genesis is back here. Now, why am I telling you this? No extra charge for this information. The word chesed is a very strong word. And here's how Dr. Walke translated it. He said it was the best translation. Because the reason I'm going here is because Ruth pronounces a blessing on her daughters-in-law. And she says, I'm leaving. But may God deal kindly with you. because Ruth knew that God was like this. And Dr. Walke said that he believed that the best translation of chesed is loyal love. Loyal love. It's this idea. What he's saying is that God loves us, but he doesn't merely love us. He loves us with a love that is completely loyal. When God reveals himself to Moses in Exodus chapter 34, he reveals himself with this word. He says, Moses, I want you to know that I am a God who is filled with loyal love. I shared a little bit of this with you back in the fall when I shared a message with you, but I just grew up with a view of God that was, well, if he cares about me, he cares about me until the next time I mess up. Until the next time I just do something that he just is just fed up and throws his arms up. But he says, may he deal kindly with you. In fact, let me give you another example. To Moses, God, here's the point, God is revealing himself this way. God says, I am a God who's filled with loyal love for you. So if you're struggling with whatever your life circumstances are right now, with how deep is the love of God for you, regardless of where you are right now, regardless of your circumstances, regardless of your behavior, this is a powerful, powerful word where God is saying, I can't forget you. I'm unable to forget you. This is one of the reasons, by the way, I suspect that the word grace, for example, is a common theme in Rod's teaching. And it's one of the reasons that Rod and I enjoy interacting with each other is because we see this in the Bible. And unfortunately, I don't think it's seen enough these days. What's seen more is, well, God loves you, and yeah, you have eternal life as long as you don't really mess up. Well, what loyal love is saying is, God is saying, I'm incapable. When I love you, when you have believed in me for eternal life, I am incapable of turning my back on you. If there was ever good news, that's the good news. God can't. In fact, remember when Jonah is called to go and preach to the Ninevites, which was the capital of Assyria. And the thing that was so upsetting to Jonah was he said, what bothers me about you, God, I'm paraphrasing here, but this is the message. Jonah says, what bothers me about you is you are so loving. I know what'll happen. If I go and preach to those people and you repent, you won't destroy them. Jonah wanted God to destroy Assyria because they were their enemies. They were the most powerful nation in the world of that day. And so he says, so bothers me about you that you are that loving. Okay. So the book of Ruth is in a time of emptiness and fullness going back and forth, but it's a time when her life, when Naomi and Ruth's life is being lived under the umbrella of the loyal love of God, the chesed of God. The Lord grant that you may find rest, each of you in the house of her husband. And then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, no, we'll return with you to your people. But Naomi said, turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? See, this was that, we're going to talk a little bit more about this next week, but this was that law of the kinsman redeemer. She's saying, I don't have any other children. And you're grown women, you've been married to my boys, but now they're gone, so you better stay here. Because they conceivably could wait. They could go back with her and wait till she had more children and wait 21 years to marry the next child. But what Ruth is really, excuse me, what Naomi is saying here is, I'm beyond childbearing age. I can't bear another son for you to marry, so stay here. Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear sons, would you therefore wait till they were grown? I mean, this is like getting right down to it here. Would you, if I had a baby and you're a grown woman, you've been married to one of my sons, would you wait for them to become of marrying age? Would you therefore wait till they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Now, Ruth is shifting a little bit here. She knows that God is loving, but she's getting a little bit bitter, okay? And she wants her daughters-in-law to stay. Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. And she said, see, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people. So Orpah went back to Moab. She said, okay, I'll stay. She's gone back to her people and to her gods, plural. Return after your sister-in-law. So she's saying, Ruth, go with Orpah. But Ruth said, do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people and your God, my God. Now, where have you heard that verse quoted before? Ever heard that quoted at a wedding? I have. A number of weddings. I don't generally use it when I do a wedding, which is not too much anymore. But this is Ruth talking to her mother-in-law. She says, no, I'm going to go with you. She has seen something in her mother-in-law, and I believe what she has seen is chesed. She's seen the loyal love of God in Naomi's life, even though her circumstances are horrible. They're broken. They're a broken family. Her husband, Naomi's husband and her two boys have died, and she has these two daughters-in-law left. And she said, see, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after her. But Ruth said, don't urge me to leave you or return from following you. And so here's the clue about Ruth. And I think this is one of the reasons we see her in the genealogy of Jesus. She's saying, wherever you go, that's where I'm going to go. Wherever you live, that's where I'm going to live. And your people will be my people and your God, my God. So Ruth, a Moabite pagan woman, is turning to the God of Israel. She's saying, your God will be my God. It's, if you will, a conversion story. She said, I'm following the God that you're following, and so I'm going with you. Now, even though this has been a difficult story and a sad story in terms of this family, it doesn't end that way. We're going to look at how it ends, and then next week we'll talk about more of the details. And then she adds, where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. So again, she's picturing this loyal love of God by saying, not only will I go with you, she's promising her mother-in-law to take care of her. She's a single woman, she's a widow, and she says, I'm going to take care of her. I'll go with you, and I will be with you until you die. In fact, she says, wherever you die, I'm going to die there too. May the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. And when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more. So the two of them went on until they came to Bethlehem. When they came to Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. And the women, so now they're back in Naomi's home, right? This is where Naomi was from. They had left Bethlehem and gone to Moab, but now she's back. So some people recognized her. They go, hold it. this is Naomi. We remember you. And the women said, is this Naomi? She said to them, don't call me Naomi, which means what? Remember what I said? Naomi means Nahom, pleasant. She's saying, don't call me pleasant. That's what Naomi is saying here. She said to them, don't call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. The Hebrew word Mara means bitter. Naomi is saying, I am no longer a pleasant woman. I'm bitter. I have allowed my life circumstances to turn me to bitterness. And what we're going to see this week and then following up next week is that it's the loyal love of God that it turns her back from bitterness to pleasant. And what will turn you and me when we're faced with difficult life circumstances, what will prevent us from going toward bitterness is the loyal love of God, the chesed of God. I went away full. She's saying, I left Bethlehem full, had a full family. And the Lord has brought me back empty. So again, this theme, emptiness, fullness, is all through the book of Ruth. Why call me Naomi? Why call me pleasant when the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me? So Naomi returned, and the Moabite, her daughter-in-law with her, who returned from the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest. Now, we're going to pick up what happens there next time. But before we do that, I want you to see this is a New Testament, and I thought it was a Old and New Testament combination, so I've got to go to the new-fashioned way of finding this verse, but bear with me, because what I'm going to share with you in closing here is pretty amazing. Remember, she's empty. She's empty and she's bitter. When we get to the end of the book, chapter 4, four chapters in the book, I'll share with you more of the story about when they get back, Ruth meets Boaz, a godly man, a respected man, and they become married. And they have a child. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. All right, so now they're back. Naomi's bitter. She's angry. But this relationship happens between Ruth, the daughter-in-law, who has made choices that she didn't have to make. She didn't have to go back with her mother-in-law. She's made choices, and she didn't have any idea how those choices were going to turn out. And the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. So Ruth has a son. Then the women said to Naomi, blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a redeemer, and may his name be renowned in Israel. She's talking about Boaz. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, for your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has given birth to him. So Ruth has followed her mother-in-law. Love story. This is a classic love story. Married Boaz. Then Naomi took the child. Here's what the next verse says. Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse. Hold on here, because this is like a staggering, pleasant ending to this story. Because what I just read to you is a terrible translation of the Hebrew. Okay? The Hebrew word here is very clear. Most translators of the Bible are committees of scholars that are mostly men, frankly. Most translation committees are made up with a bunch of men who refuse to translate this passage like it's written. Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse. She didn't lay the child on her lap. That's not the Hebrew word. The Hebrew word that they translate lap is breast. She took the child to this group of men, apparently. You can imagine, there's a bunch of men sitting around and saying, well, she's beyond childbearing age. She's postmenopausal. You know, obviously, it wasn't her breast. I'm giving you the Bible as it's written here, okay? She became his nurse. She nursed. She's gone from fullness to emptiness to fullness, where she is actually nursing her own grandchild. Now, I've done some reading about this, and in some countries where women give birth who are unable to nurse their child, sometimes an older woman, and yes, even a grandmother, can nurse a child. And what it depends on is the bond that exists between the older woman and the infant. Now, I'm going there because what could be more of a picture of fullness, emptiness and back to fullness, than her life is not only full, she has a grandson, but she's even filled with milk enough to nurse her own grandchild. I love that conclusion that the author, we don't know who wrote the book of Ruth. We know it was much later because there are some aspects of the book that the author has to explain because he figured people didn't understand all the details. But we'll come back to that next week. But she dies, the book ends with her life full again. So I think what we see here is that our life isn't determined by our circumstances. It's determined by, am I living under, embracing the chesed, the loyal love of God? And that's what I hope, no matter what your circumstances are, is that you can just acknowledge, Lord, it's not about my circumstances. It's about you. And where I have to take myself every time I'm down or think, I wish this were different, is to take myself back to the loyal love of God. So there you go. Lord, thanks for our time together this morning. Thank you that you are God who is full of loyal love for us, so much so that you can't forget your love for us no matter what. Bless our time now as we worship, as we close by singing, and cause it to be a time of high worship of you, in Jesus' name, amen.